Our temperatures have been nice and cool, and let's talk a little bit about why this is happening and how important this is, especially here in Northern California during the summer months. Yeah, we're well into July, and typically we think of triple digit temperatures, and we haven't had it, and this is the reason why. Let's go over here to the Weather World Monitor, the big TV screen showing. This is a satellite picture of California, and you can see where we have the low cloud cover along the coast of California. That's what we call the marine layer, and this is what's been really helping to keep our temperatures pretty close to average for this time of year. This is what we can see. And as long as we have this around, it cools things off nicely at night, and it helps to keep our temperatures, well, at least what we've been seeing is mid-90s. So still feels like summer during the afternoon, but not as hot as it could get. If we didn't have this marine layer, we would definitely be seeing some triple-digit temperatures. So temperatures right now outside, these are your late morning temperatures in the mid to low 70s up and down the valley, 69 degrees in Fairfield, and a cool 66 degrees in San Francisco. How's that for a July day? 73 at Lake Tahoe and 70 degrees currently in Truckee. Nice onshore breeze that we call the Delta breeze. Once it makes its way in through the Delta, we have a 20 mile an hour wind currently in Solano County in the Fairfield area, helping to pump in that cooler air. And again, we're going to feel the effects of that later on this evening as that Delta breeze, it backs off during the afternoon, and then it picks up again as we head towards the evening. So late afternoon into the evening, we see the breeze return and temperatures drop off after our daytime highs that are expected to be ranging in the mid-90s today. So it's still going to be a sunny day. It's still going to be a very warm day, but we get that nice relief overnight in the valley because of that onshore breeze and because of the marine layer that's sitting about 2,000 feet thick. That's a lot of cloud cover along the coast helping to cool things off. So big picture here. It's time to take a look at, well, where we spy the lows and the highs across the area. Can you see anything? Well, we can kind of make some things out. You might be able to make out where we have some high pressure and low pressure. But what I want to do is I want to change the map. We're going to take a look at this now with a different sensor in a satellite that measures the water vapor in the atmosphere. And so it's looking for water vapor. And you can see those areas where there's blue and the white. That's where you have more water vapor in the atmosphere. And the areas that are black and on into kind of a brownish color, orange brown color, that's where we have very dry conditions. So you can see we have very dry conditions across our area. That's why we don't have any cloud cover overhead. You need water vapor for that. But what we're looking at right now is where things are spinning, the direction things are spinning. Where do we have the areas of high pressure and low pressure? So what I see, we can see, let's start right here over Texas. You can see the clouds wrapping around this direction. That's going to be clockwise. That means we have an area of high pressure, an anticyclone over here. We have another one that's to our west out in the eastern Pacific, spinning around, again, counterclockwise. We have that. And then most of the areas of low pressure that are spinning counterclockwise, I should say, are all to the north. So these are all spinning clockwise. The high pressure is spinning clockwise. The areas of low pressure here, and low pressure here are all spinning around counterclockwise. But what's happening right along the coast here, the west coast in California, we actually have this dry air, and it's spinning around counterclockwise. So we have an area of low pressure, and this is critical with the marine layer. This has allowed for that marine layer to develop below that dry air above, and we're seeing the moisture down below along the coast because the temperatures are so cool that they reach what's called dew point. And we're going to talk a little bit more about dew point later on in our Weather World segment, but right now let's go ahead and take a look at some of the questions that we have. And we're going to start with a question that talks a little bit about the ocean, a little bit about condensation, a little bit about precipitation. This question, first one for today, comes from Luella Fullerton. And she says, how does seawater evaporate, turn into clouds, and then fall to the earth as fresh water? So that's a good question. And to answer that, we need to talk a little bit about the water cycle. And for that, let's go over to the Weather World chroma key and do a little explainer. I'm going to leave that there. The water cycle. So here we go. Here's our water cycle. We start things off, of course, talking about the ocean, because that's a big source of water vapor in the air is the ocean. We've got a lot of evaporation that takes place over the ocean. So seawater, it's about 3.5% salt. So in volume, it's not a lot of salt, but if you've ever been swimming in the ocean and maybe had a wave crash it and you've tumbled around and you swallowed some salt water from the sea, yeah, you definitely notice that salt. It is something you don't really like to swallow because it doesn't taste very good. And so there is some salt in the sea. Now what happens is, of course, the sun helps in the evaporation process. What it does is it starts to heat things up. And the warmer that the sea gets, then the more evaporation that's going to take place. Now with the evaporation taking place, what happens is that it's actually just the fresh water that's evaporating from the ocean, while the heavier salts that are in the ocean, it remains behind. So that's not evaporating. So that's the process. It's kind of like you have a distillation. Have you ever heard of that, where you're taking something and you're taking out, again, the fresh water and leaving behind everything else? So that's what's taking place here, is you have the fresh water is evaporating and it's leaving all the salts behind and the minerals behind. And so you have fresh water that's turning into the water vapor. Now, as the air rises, we all know that the higher you go, the cooler it gets. And temperatures eventually are going to cool enough where you get condensation to occur. So water vapor then cools and condenses into clouds. And those clouds, they move around. You've got the jet stream and the motion of the atmosphere that pushes those clouds around, and they transport the liquid water. Again, the clouds are made out of liquid water. They went from a water vapor condensed into a liquid and then transporting now over land. And what happens? Well, we get over land and you get the right dynamics, light, right energy, and all those things equal up to precipitation that falls in the form of a little bit of snow in the upper elevations where it's cold enough for some snow, or some rain as it makes its way further down the mountain. Of course, then what happens is all that transports out eventually to the sea. Not all at once, of course, but over time, we do see that water, it moves around. And as it's moving around over the earth, guess what it's doing? It's dissolving out the salts and the minerals that are in the earth, and those get transported back out to the ocean. And that is why the ocean is so salty. So we have the fresh water that falls from the clouds, we have the salt water in the ocean, but it's only the fresh water that evaporates into the sky and turns into those clouds. So we get the fresh water in the clouds, then eventually precipitating down and then keeping that cycle. That's why they call it a cycle. You got a big circle that takes place as it continues to rotate around in the atmosphere. So hopefully that answers your question, and maybe it may spark another question that you might have. Make sure you contact me about that. Let's go ahead and talk about the next question that we have. This next question, let's see, comes from Mark Almer, and he says, we live at 4,000 feet in Grizzly Flats, and notice that every time a snowstorm approaches, the wind blows significantly, but the wind stops when it starts to snow. So as the storm is approaching, they notice the wind, but after it starts snowing, they don't notice the wind as much. So why? Here's two parts here. Why does the wind blow before it snows? And two, why does it stop when it's snowing? So to answer this question, let's use the whiteboard. We've got actually different parts here. First of all, we have to realize that an area of low pressure. So here's my area of low pressure. I'm going to draw an L here. Wind blows from high pressure to low pressure. And so if you have an area of low pressure, that means all the wind is going to be going in towards the area of low pressure. It doesn't go directly in. It actually kind of curves as it goes in. So that's the direction that the winds are going to be blowing. And when we're talking about a weather system that's going to produce snow, usually there's a boundary that's associated with that, because we have cold air coming in from the north, and then we have warmer air that's coming up from the south. And so we get this line that forms. In fact, I'm going to erase this one here. And we call this a cold front. You got this line, and usually they're a blue triangle. And that blue triangle tells you that there's the colder air that's moving. And these little triangles here are pointing in the direction that this cold front, or the colder air, is moving. So as this cold air moves in, it's bumping into this warm air. And when you have a battle between cold air and warm air, guess who wins? Well, the cold air, it's heavier, and so it stays low, and the warm air goes high, it goes up above. And as it gets pushed up, it cools, you have condensation, and you have the formation of a storm that develops. And so here's my clouds that are right here along this boundary. And with this boundary, then if it's cold enough, we get in the wintertime, it's kind of neat to be talking about wintertime storms in the summertime, but when we have this come through, the snow starts to fall in the colder air behind. And so it's right here at this transition. So out in front of this storm, you have winds coming up from the south. Behind the storm, you actually have winds coming from the northwest. So usually it's from the southwest, or in our case, usually from the south in our area, and then coming from the northwest. So you have winds coming from the northwest, and here coming from the southwest. And the winds are stronger out in front of the cold front. And so the direction, usually, the direction and, of course, where the cold front is moving play a part. So if you live here in California, and I'm going to go ahead and draw, here's the Bay Area. Here we have Tahoe. And then you have the Sierra Nevada mountains here. And you have the coastal mountains here. And then let's say Grizzly Flats is right in here. There's Grizzly Flats. So as the cold front approaches, we have our line. And we have the blue triangles. The wind up here is coming from this direction. The wind from here is coming from this direction. So in this particular location, the winds are probably noticed more coming from the south, because where you're located, it also depends on the terrain, the topography. If you're in a valley that's pointing north and south, you're going to notice those winds more coming from the south. And if the winds are coming from the northwest, you might be sheltered by it. And so you're not going to notice that change as the cold front comes through. So the winds will be strongest before the cold front arrives. You'll have those winds increasing. After the cold front comes through, so here I'm gonna draw another line. Here's my cold front beyond Grizzly Flats. What's gonna happen? Well, the winds are gonna change. The winds are now, because the cold front has passed, coming more from the northwest, and they may not be as strong in the wake. So this is going to be a more stable atmosphere behind once you get past there, but you'll have the snow right along the cold front. And so as the snow begins, that's the transition. We're going from the warmer air to the cooler air. You get the shift in the winds, and you may not notice the winds as much because they may not be nearly as strong as when the cold front or the weather system is coming through. So that is why when the winds shift and you get the different air masses that come through, you get that change in the winds and the change in the strength of the winds. And so as the snow starts to fall, that's the signal, the cold front's coming on through, and you don't notice the winds. Hopefully that makes sense. But that's a great question. I love delving into those things. So thanks, Mark, for that question. Third question that we have for today. And this is all kind of related to what we've been talking about. This comes from Dan Davidson, and he says, what is the difference between humidity and dew point? Great question. Let's talk about that. So, the atmosphere, I'm gonna put this here. This is gonna represent our atmosphere. And this is going to have a temperature of about 60 degrees. This pitcher has water in it, but we're going to, for our purposes here of explaining what dew point is and what relative humidity is, we have to think about this liquid water as being water vapor. So this is going to be water vapor. I'm going to magically turn it into water vapor by putting some drops of food coloring in there, and that way we can see it better. And that's going to represent our water vapor. So let's go ahead and stir this up. And there we have our water vapor, nice and blue. It's a deep blue. So relative humidity is the measurement of how much water vapor the atmosphere is holding. So in this case, our atmosphere can hold this much water from the bottom of the vase to the top here of the glass that we have. And so if I pour in the water vapor, and it becomes half full or half empty, depending on how you look at things, this now is 50%. The relative humidity is 50%. If it's half full or half empty, its capacity would be 100%, and it's halfway full of water vapor, and so now it's sitting at 50%. So that's our relative humidity. It's 50% at 60 degrees, the temperature. Now, an interesting thing with the atmosphere is as you change the temperature, the ability for the atmosphere to hold water vapor changes along with it. So what we're going to do now is we're going to change the temperature of our atmosphere. And as we heat things up, guess what happens? Its ability to hold water vapor increases. So now we have a bigger container. The atmosphere, as we warm it up, it's able to hold more water vapor. So here we take the same amount of water vapor, but we heat up the atmosphere, and what happens? As we go through, let's say it's a day. So we start off the morning at 60 degrees, a nice cool temperature in the morning. We get later in the morning, temperatures start to heat up. Well, the atmosphere's capacity to hold water vapor increases. So now look at it. Now we're down to about 33%. It's about a third of the way full. So its humidity, its relative humidity, is now dropped to about 33%. So it went from 50% humidity down to about 33% humidity. But now a cold front comes through, just like we talked about. We have a nice cold air mass moving across Northern California. What happens to the atmosphere? Well, you have this big container that's able to hold all this water vapor. As we cool it down, it starts to shrink. So temperatures start to drop. And we're gonna drop down to 40 degrees now. And so guess what happens to our atmosphere? Its ability to hold water vapor decreases. And as that happens, the relative humidity changes. So how full is our glass now? I don't know if you can notice that, but there's the top of the glass right there. And it's 100% full. So the relative humidity is going to be 100%. And so there's gonna be, it's at saturation. You've got all this water vapor that's in the air and it's ready to go. All you need is just a little trigger and then you can start getting some precipitation, a little bit of rain or snow, depending on how cold it is. Right now it would be rain because we're at 40 degrees. But guess what? Even colder air is coming in behind this. We're gonna drop our temperature down to 30 degrees. Look at this, our poor little atmosphere. Its ability to hold the water vapor has decreased even more. And what happens to the water vapor? Oh no! It's spilling out and we're getting a great snowstorm. It's still falling and falling and falling and falling and making a mess. That's the pan here at the bottom. So we're supersaturated. No, but what happened? This is still at 100%, but we've got a lot more water vapor changing into liquid water or solid water in this case with temperatures down to 30, but we're down to 100% humidity still. So really what's interesting now is we start warming things up. We take our 100% and look at that. There's much less water vapor in this one, but now we change it over here. Look at that. Much less water vapor over here. And then if we warm it back up to 70 degrees, look at that, the relative humidity. That's like down to 10%. So you have much less of the water in here because it all precipitated out when the temperature was down to 30 degrees. So that's a really important concept when you're talking about the atmosphere, when we're talking about rainstorms, snowstorms, stormy weather, and the temperature of the atmosphere in comparison with how much water vapor is in the air. These are important things, especially when you're forecasting what's going on with the weather, and it plays into a lot. So hopefully that answered your question. So dew point was when we reached 100% humidity here at 40 degrees, and its dew point dropped down to 30 degrees as we had more of that water vapor spill out and precipitate out. And so the dew point is the temperature at which the atmosphere starts to see condensation and precipitation in the air. So really it's condensation, you get the droplets of water. So we're going from a water vapor to a liquid. So that's the dew point. That's when dew starts to form on the grass in the morning. So that's where it gets its name, dew point. Relative humidity is the amount of water vapor that's in the air at any particular temperature that we have, and it's measuring whether it's half full or three quarters full or down to just a quarter full or less, or 100% full. And so that's what relative humidity measures, is this, the atmosphere's ability to hold water vapor, while dew point is that point, that temperature that we get down to where we see actually condensation start to occur. So that answers the questions, but hopefully it might raise a question or two more in your mind. Think about the things that we thought, what we talked about today, and try to apply them into the things you come across every day. It's wonderful to explore science because it answers questions, but always it brings about more questions. And if you have a question, go ahead and contact me at dverdoorn@hirsch.com. You can also message me on Facebook. Send in your questions. I'll read through the questions. I love the questions because guess what we get to do? We get to both learn together. Thanks for viewing today. And again, hopefully we all learned something. And I look forward to next time where we can meet and talk about the weather and science, and answer some questions. Have a wonderful day.